Is your salmon supposed to look gray? That's disgusting. Commercial fish farms have been changing the color of your fish to boost their sales, along with a heap of other dangerous methods. They promise a sustainable future for seafood, but at what environmental and ethical cost? Let's dive deep beneath the surface. The vibrant history of fish farming, or aquaculture, takes us on a journey that spans millennia. From its humble beginnings in ancient civilizations to its status today as a cornerstone of global seafood production. Around 2000 BCE in China, people began domesticating carp in ponds. And similarly, ancient Egyptians began cultivating tilapia in Nile-adjacent ponds. They were the first known global roots of fish farming. The Romans, known for their ornamental fish ponds, and the European monasteries of the Middle Ages with their practical approach to food security through pond farming, were also huge proponents of fish farming. But the scientific advancements of the 19th and 20th centuries marked a significant turning point in aquaculture, primarily driven by the developments in formulated feeds, aeration technology, and disease control. In this same period of time, there was also the pivotal introduction of corn and soy into fish diets that would forever change the state of global fish farming. But the shift towards incorporating corn into fish diets is only a century old. This shift was motivated by the need for sustainable, cost-effective alternatives to traditional fish meal. However, the repercussions of using corn and grains as fish feed, such as water pollution, the debate over genetically modified crops, and the impact on fish nutritional quality are huge points of contention within the debate. And the broader food industry doesn't agree. Nutritionally, corn's lower protein content and lack of essential omega-3 fatty acids necessitate careful formulation and supplementation to meet the dietary needs of the fish. So when we compare the diets of farmed fish and the natural diets of wild fish, we end up seeing glaring differences and monumental dietary impacts on the fish and on you. So on top of this, the scarcity of essential omega-3 fatty acids in corn, which is vital for both the neurological development of fish and the health benefits of seafood for humans, raises concern. Digestive inefficiencies pose another challenge, as some fish species struggle to efficiently process high carbohydrate levels present in corn. This can lead to slower growth rates, increased waste production, and consequently greater environmental impact due to nutrient runoff and water quality degradation. And all of this is not even to mention the fact that farmed fish just tastes worse. The composition of the fish feed can influence the taste, texture, and nutritional profile of the fish flesh. Diets high in corn can affect the fatty acid composition of the fish, potentially leading to a decrease in the highly desirable omega-3 fatty acid content. Personally, I can tell the difference. So if all this is true, what really makes the wild fish healthier for you? Wild fish typically consume a natural diet consisting mainly of smaller fish, plankton, and algae, which is high in omega-3 fatty acids and results in a favorable omega-3 to omega-6 ratio. While farmed fish remain a good source of protein and certain vitamins and minerals, the reduction in omega-3 fatty acids and increase in omega-6 fatty acids could diminish some of the cardiovascular and anti-inflammatory benefits traditionally associated with fish consumption. Wild fish are also constantly on the move, searching for food, avoiding predators. This active lifestyle results in leaner fish with firmer, denser muscle tissue, which can affect the texture and possibly the nutritional content, offering higher amounts of certain minerals and vitamins. Is there a negative side effect to wild fish consumption? To a degree, certain wild fish, especially the larger predatory species, can accumulate higher levels of mercury and other toxins. But on the flip side, farmed fish can also be exposed to higher levels of contaminants and toxins due to their dense living conditions and the potential use of feed that may contain pollutants. In contrast, wild fish generally have lower levels of pollutants like PCBs, dioxins, and antibiotics depending on their habitat. Countries such as China, Vietnam, Thailand, Indonesia, Norway, and Chile have witnessed many of these severe negative impacts of unregulated or inadequately managed aquaculture growth, from environmental degradation to the socio-economic consequences affecting local communities and biodiversity. While economically viable for the companies producing the fish, the corn feed methods become economically damaging for everyone else. The rise of mass-produced farm fish is severely destabilizing the wild fish market, which is primarily driven by the local communities. And in turn, as fish farming expands, it is the locals that suffer the most. So now you know the fish you are eating might be toxic, and you know that most countries around the world simply don't care about the negative impacts of large-scale fish farming and what it does to the environment and the human population. And you also know that these fish farms are absolutely ruining the lives of impoverished fishermen around the world. However, none of this is stopping you from buying fish from your local supermarket. But maybe if you knew that your farm salmon was actually gray and not the vibrant orange color you see in supermarkets, you might stop buying it, right? Well, knowing this, fish farms use a simple trick: changing the color of the unnatural farm fish into something you would find in the wild. And then the buying never stops. The utilization of specific dyes, notably astaxanthin and canthaxanthin, plays a crucial role in achieving the desired coloration in farmed fish such as salmon, trout, and shrimp. What the hell is astaxanthin and canthaxanthin? Well, let's find out. Astaxanthin, a naturally occurring carotenoid, and canthaxanthin, although similar, have distinct paths in regulatory and consumer landscapes. The former is typically considered safer for consumption, while the latter is associated with health concerns at high levels. At high doses, canthaxanthin has caused a serious, potentially fatal blood disorder called aplastic anemia. Canthaxanthin can also cause diarrhea, nausea, stomach cramps, dry and itchy skin, hives, orange or red body secretions, and other side effects. This makes the demand for transparency and natural aquaculture practices reflect a growing consumer ethos seeking clarity on food origins and production methodologies. One such company that has taken a stand on this is Seatopia. They realize that kelp's natural pigments offer a sustainable alternative to synthetic dyes, enhancing the visual appeal of farm fish without compromising on safety or sustainability. By reducing the dependence on dwindling wild fish stocks and embracing kelp cultivation, we can alleviate the strain on marine ecosystems, stepping towards a more sustainable future in aquaculture. But all this aside, can we at least all agree that wild fish tastes better anyway? Additionally, kelp farm fish exhibit enhanced omega-3 content due to kelp's natural omega-3 composition. This not only boosts the fish's health and disease resistance, but significantly betters the nutritional offer to us. The modern Western diet has skewed the omega-6 to omega-3 ratio alarmingly. The imbalance has shifted from a historical norm of around 1-to-1 to a disproportionate 15-to-1 or even 20-to-1. We need to restore the balance. Given these advancements, incorporating kelp farm fish into our diets emerges as a potent strategy for enhancing our omega fatty acid intake, aligning with broader dietary recommendations aimed at correcting the prevalent omega imbalance. As the aquaculture industry strides into the future, there are loads of other trends making their way into the industry. Integrated multi-trophic aquaculture stands out as a revolutionary approach. By cultivating different species together, such as fish, shellfish, and seaweeds, in a symbiotic system where each species' byproducts serve as nutrients for another, IMTA champions a sustainable ecosystem that mimics natural processes. Recirculating aquaculture systems, RAS, and aquaponics are also setting new benchmarks in sustainability and resource efficiency. RAS drastically reduces the need for fresh water and minimizes environmental waste discharge. Aquaponics, on the other hand, marries aquaculture with hydroponics in a closed-loop system that exemplifies maximum resource utilization by using fish waste to nourish hydroponically grown plants, which in turn purify the water. And I will say, not all sustainably farmed seafood is created equal, so please do your research. While the path to integrating sustainable aquaculture practices like kelp-based feeds into the mainstream market faces challenges, these hurdles are navigable with focused efforts from all of us. As we continue to explore and advocate for sustainable aquaculture, your awareness and support are invaluable. Are you going to pay more attention to the type of fish you buy now? What aspects of fish farming did we miss? Let us know down in the comments below. Also, if you found our discussion today valuable, I encourage you to please like this video and subscribe to our channel. Don't forget to hit the notification bell so you never miss an episode. Thank you for watching, and we look forward to seeing you in the next video.